Welcome to the Perspectives on Healthcare podcast, where members of the medical community from different roles, venues, and locations share their unique perspectives on quality healthcare, its future, and how to improve it. Now, from the Your Keynote Speaker studio in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, here is your host, Rob Oliver.
Thank you, and welcome to another episode of Perspectives on Healthcare. My guest today is Alison Proffit. She is a former HR manager with experience in elder care. She is out in Colorado. She is a member of Generation X. And Alison, welcome to the podcast.
Thank you so much, Rob, for having me. I'm excited to be here for our conversation.
No, I'm looking forward to it. So tell me a little bit about yourself and your role in healthcare, please.
Yeah, for sure. So I spent 15 years working in the human resources field, and I moved out of that field to do more work in the leadership and personal development space. So I actually now run my own business called Proffit Coach, where I do what I call holistic life leadership and business coaching, helping leaders and small business owners approach their work from a place of joy. And a lot of that is informed from all the work that I did in human resources. When I worked in HR, most of that experience happened when I was actually out in the Philadelphia, Pennsylvania area. So the other side of the state from where you're broadcasting from. And now, like you said, I'm here in Fort Collins, Colorado, but the work I did in HR, I worked in a lot of different industries, but working in a continuing care retirement community is the last HR job I had. And it was probably the most fulfilling. I find that the people that work in that industry are doing that work often because it's really important and fulfilling to them, even though in terms of the boots on the ground, the people behind the scenes, they don't always make a whole lot of money. But they're the ones that really make it all happen. Those CNAs and the dietary aides and the housekeepers and all those other things, the nurses, of course, but there's also all those other underlying things that until I worked in that industry, I didn't necessarily have quite the appreciation for the entire healthcare field as I did after working in that role.
Yeah. Can you comment on that a little bit? Because to me, I keep hearing this recurring theme that people are drawn to working in healthcare because they want to help people. And yet sometimes you end up with kind of the experience of this system creates extra stress and burnout and issues. Can you comment about kind of the interplay between what happens with what draws people into the industry and then what happens to them once they get in there and start working in that system?
Oh, yeah. I love that question. And I actually think the work I do now in my business really has given me even more lens into that. So this isn't necessarily just healthcare people, but people that move into what I would call helping professions. They do it because they really care about other people. They want to help. They're very heart-centered, they have concern for the well-being of other people and their fellow humans. And they feel good when they pour out of their cup into other people's cups. And what happens often is they burn themselves out because they're not refilling their own cup. And this might really trigger some people. But there's often a tendency to be a people pleaser when you are a helper. And you don't understand how to kind of set boundaries around things. And so you'll just keep saying yes, because you think that's what you're supposed to do. And I find that that's really true in working with a lot of those employees who felt like, well, I'm just a CNA, so I can't go to the director of nursing and say these things, or I'm just the dishwasher in the kitchen. I can't go to the executive chef and share some of my concerns that I'm noticing. Or share my ideas or my observations, right? Because they feel like, well, I'm just here. I'm just washing the dishes because I want to, you know, help and contribute to the team in that way. But I don't know how to like stand up for my own self. Does that make sense?
It does. And I will just key on one of the things that you said there. So many times people use the word just. I am just this, or I am just that. And to me, it's really important. People don't value necessarily, let's just say, the dishwasher, right? And it's just, I'm just a dishwasher. But without the dishwasher, then the executive chef has no clean silverware, no clean plates, no clean way to serve the food. And you take that a step further, and that is, if the dishes aren't being cleaned properly, then you're having problems with contamination, you're having problems with cleanliness, you're having a whole litany of problems. And in that, the people may feel like they're low on the totem pole. They may feel like they're not in a position of appreciation or, you know, value, but they are a link in the chain. And obviously your chain is only as strong as its weakest link. So every single link is vital and important. So
exactly. I love that. And I think, if I may just mention one thing related to that, Rob, because I think you make a really great point. The leaders that you have listening to this that are in the healthcare field, it's their job to kind of very lovingly communicate that to all their staff, not just assume that the dishwasher knows and understands all the different ways that they help them pass inspections. And why that really matters, how much money that costs when they get fined, when an inspector comes through and something is missing, and all of those people who are the boots on the ground. And I think that can be really difficult because a leader always has so many different things to do. But when you convey the why and give context to why these standard operating procedures exist and why sometimes it's not just so easy to change this from what it is, that there is a process. So communication is the foundation of all leadership, of all great relationships. So the conveying that you're not just a dishwasher, or you're not just a housekeeper, or whatever that role may be. And I think that goes both ways too, right? There has to be a respect of the leaders. And that's where I think a really strong HR person has that ability to cross those bridges, like get people to walk across that bridge and hold the hands together so that they're one's not leading the other, so to speak.
Sure. What does quality healthcare mean to you?
Oh, this is such a great question, because I think I can look at it through multiple lenses. I can look at it through my own lens. I can look at it through the lens of being responsible for the HR aspect of helping to run a quality elder care facility. To me, it does look like the physical quality of the spaces and making sure that they're clean, right? Cleanliness, I think, is really important. But I think when you walk into a healthcare facility, there's something really intangible around how it feels when you walk in the space. Of course, the quality comes from the care that's being provided and are they certified and qualified to be doing what they're doing. But if you walk into a place and it's missing that intangible feeling of, oh, I feel like I'm cared about here. I feel like I'm supported. I'm not just a number on the call sheet. And that takes cultivation in an organization. So I think it's the people that are providing the care. It's the feeling that you get when you're walking into the space. It's the feeling that the person that you're talking to is giving you the time and attention and not just rushing through, even though they have many things to do. And not feeling like you're a burden to that healthcare provider, that you really are able to get your questions answered. And the landscape we're in right now, I think, is really difficult in the healthcare world. And there are some practitioners that I think are doing a phenomenal job. I had COVID back in November and the doctor was so amazing. And I go to a big practice.
Sure.
And I ended up having to pick a primary care doctor, and I knew I was going to pick him. And when I had my first appointment with him last month to follow up on some personal things, I shared with him my experience of that, of how much his bedside mattered to me.
Right.
When I literally felt the sickest I've ever felt in a really, really, really long time. Cause he popped in before he even, like, he just saw the nurse walking me down the hallway. And after she did the vitals, he popped in, he said, "I can tell that you feel horrible. We're running your lab work. And I promise we're going to be right back to you as quickly as possible." I mean, that was so, he did not need to do that.
Sure.
And so that intangible thing.
Yeah, no problem. And the next question is, you know, asking for an example of quality healthcare. And I think that you've answered that question with what you just provided from your own personal life. And I want to say thank you for being willing to share your own experience with that. What do you wish people understood about your role in healthcare? And this is an intriguing question to me because so many times we think about the front end of healthcare and we don't think about the back office side of it. So I'm curious to hear your thoughts on this.
Oh yeah. So leaders are everything in an organization, and HR leaders in an organization can often be it's like the glue. They're cultivating safe spaces for managers to feel heard, for employees to feel heard, to build those bridges to those conversations when there's conflict or when there's something that needs to be investigated or when there's something that needs to be celebrated. A really quality HR professional behind the scenes is making sure that people are supported, that and that means a lot of things, right? That means that they're being paid fairly and equitably. That means that they're being reviewed properly, that they're being trained properly, that they're being hired effectively, that the culture and the environment are not just good outwardly facing to the customers and the patients that they're serving, but that internal customer service. And I can't remember if we're going to go into this, but I'll just, if I may, share that one of the things I'm navigating this in my own life right now with my aging parents and just assessing healthcare and where they might end up in terms of living in a community of some sort at some point. And I plan on talking to the employees, and a receptionist is a really great place to start, asking them, "How long have you been here? What do you like about working here?" And think about yourself, put yourself in the shoes of an employee. If you think of your company that you work at, if you were to ask yourself, do I feel support? If somebody asked me those questions, how would you respond? That's the kind of stuff you're looking for in a healthcare organization. And talking to the bill pay people, right? The people that do collections. Do you like working there? In all of those interactions, don't be afraid of asking that question. Because the other thing too, is that the employees like to have those conversations. Hmm.
Yeah. So what I'm thinking about though, it is, you talked about the environment and you talked about the feeling that you get when you're there. And in some ways, when you're looking at the employees, when the employees are happy, when there's a good culture within that organization, it is, as you said earlier, it's easier to care for other people when you are being cared for yourself. If, you know, so when you're in an organization that has a lot of turnover, a lot of stress, a lot of angst and anxiety, that is going to be passed along to the people that are receiving care there. And it's going to have an impact on the quality of the care that they receive. What excites you about the future of healthcare?
One thing that I think is exciting is there is a different kind of accessibility in the virtual world. And we were talking a little bit about the way that Zoom has changed our ability to get a glimpse into people's real lives, right? Their dogs come on screen and you're like, "Oh, hey, Fluffy," you know? So I think that there's something really powerful about the fact that, somebody might be living across the country and being able to Zoom call into a meeting with their loved one and their doctor. And I think that that's really pretty powerful. I think it allows there to be a different kind of advocacy. I think even though there may be a slippery slope of like, oh, everything's electronic and it's just in the You know, there's so many healthcare organizations that are using communication apps where you can log in and you can view notes and get messages and things like that. And I just think that that has increased access in some ways, in terms of being able to have virtual appointments and getting information through your healthcare app. That's been really helpful just in navigating the stuff with my parents, is having the ability to log into their stuff and see it. Of course, I, you know, HIPAA and all that, I have permission. And
sure.
But I think that that's pretty exciting, about just, wow, like what else is possible when it comes to that? Is there a specialist that might be able to dial into a virtual appointment, in order to provide this higher level of expertise? Whereas before it was like, oh, you have to, you know, fly them in, or you have to go somewhere. And I think it just kind of creates some really neat, opportunities.
Yeah. I hadn't thought of that, but the idea that, you know, your parents are in one place and they can meet with their doctor, but then you can bring in a specialist from far away and you can be far away, and just everybody can be virtually in the same room. What a concept I had not thought of before. So
yeah.
What is one thing medical professionals can start doing today to increase the quality of healthcare?
Talk to your employees and care about them. Like really, really care about them. And it's been a number of years since I've worked in the HR field. So I suspect that there's been some shifting with the pandemic and how people are showing up in that space. But I think really, really caring about them and doing your best to not just look at them as an employee, but look at them as a whole human. That was always a passion of mine, is you can't expect people to leave their half of themselves at the time clock. They are going to bring whatever is happening for them in with them. Even if they're not talking about it, it's there.
Right.
And so allow that to be and accommodate however you can, even if it's just, hey, if you need to come into my office and have a 10-minute conversation, not just shuttling them over to HR. I think that there's so many people that are afraid of crossing lines because there's laws out there and things of that nature. But I have found, and I know that you're really passionate about the disability, you know, kind of creating spaces where workplaces are more accessible and open to exploring supporting people with disabilities. Don't be afraid of what you don't know. And knowing requires having conversations with the employees, with the person that's actually having the experience.
Sure. It's so interesting. I don't know if I've mentioned this on air before, but I remember hearing about an office that had a personal issue basket by the front door so that when you came in, you were to drop your personal issues in the basket so that you could go about and do your work. And there was a sign that said something along the lines of, you know, like, feel free to pick them up on your way out, but make sure that you claim your own and not someone else's issues. So there's a part of it that I see humor in, but there's also that you, and I think it's so interesting to hear you say this. A lot of people, when they talk about quality healthcare, are saying you need to do this for the patient, for the client, for the customer, whatever you want to call them. And you're saying it actually starts from a leadership position. Take care of your employees, which is going to empower them to increase the way that they take care of the patients. Super interesting. Listen, Alison Proffit, thank you so much for being here today. I appreciate you sharing your story, and I appreciate and respect your perspective on healthcare.
Thanks for listening to Perspectives on Healthcare. Visit perspectivesonhealthcare.com to learn more about Rob Oliver or to subscribe so you never miss an episode. If this podcast was valuable, we'd appreciate a review on iTunes. Or if you tell a friend or coworker about the show, that would be helpful too. Join us again next time for more Perspectives on Healthcare.